There are three stages of chanting. These are not Namaparad, Namabhasa, and Shudhanam. There are different stages. They're stages of time. So I want to present this to you. It is something that we teach in our Japa workshop. And I think it'll be really helpful. So what's the first stage? This is like stage within a day, not a stage this way, but a linear stage. The first stage is the stage of preparing the mood for chanting, preparing the soil. Because sometimes we chant without any preparation. We just go into our chanting with the same mindset that we go through all our activities. There's no adjustment. There's no meditator's mood. We don't enter into a certain receiver's mood, a certain consciousness to be present to the holy name, to pray, to have an intention, an appreciation, whatever it is that would help us go more deeply. We need to do that before we chant. Pray to our spiritual master, pray to Srila Prabhupada, pray to the acharyas. Focus on our need, pray for purity, pray to overcome an obstacle. Whatever it is, that intention, that mood needs to be entered before we begin. And it's not a mood of thinking. It's a mood within the heart, a feeling, a consciousness. A lot of times when we tell devotees enter a mood, then they start thinking about it. And they're not actually entering the mood. They're thinking about the mood they should enter. The thinking needs to stop and you actually feel. What is it? What is your intention? What is that feeling? What does it feel like to be present? What does it feel like to receive the mantra rather than try to make the mantra happen? You get in that mood, we could say attitude, state of consciousness. So that's stage one. Stage two is when you're actually chanting and you're going more deeply into that mood. Now, if you're more advanced, there are more advanced moods. You might be meditating on Krishna's form. You might be meditating on the deity and putting Krishna on a throne and decorating him, or you might be meditating on some of Krishna's pastimes. Or you might just be praying for a need, or praying to be eternally engaged in service, or praying that your heart becomes one with Krishna. Whatever it is you're doing in that chanting, whatever intention you set, you deepen that intention. You deepen that experience. So let's say I'm praying to Krishna to come closer, to bring my heart closer. So as I chant, I'm going more deeply into that mood, more deeply into that prayer, becoming more absorbed. So whatever intentions and moods and attitudes we set out to do in stage one, then in stage two, which is while we're chanting, we deepen it. Now, a lot of you might be saying, yeah, but when I chant, after a while, I get distracted. I understand that. That is a common problem. But stage two is not the stage where we're supposed to be distracted. It's the stage where we take off from stage one and become more absorbed in the intention we made. So I'm just explaining this to you so you can be more cognizant when you're chanting that I need to do stage one before stage two. And in stage two, this is what I'm doing. Just absorption. I'm turning off my life. I'm becoming more absorbed in the holy name, feeling it, hearing it, praying to it, etc. More absorbed in Krishna. As the minutes go by, I should be becoming more absorbed. That's stage two, not less absorbed, as often happens. And stage three is our life. It's what we're doing when we're not chanting. And yes, what we're doing when we're not chanting has an effect on our japa. Many devotees have told me when they're reading Krishna book or reading Bhagavatam more, their japa is better because they're more absorbed in thinking of Krishna. Many devotees have told me that their japa has been destroyed because they were very critical of someone and they actually couldn't focus in their chanting. They couldn't feel, they couldn't put the proper mood in. The mercy was taken away. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur said something very interesting. The question was posed, how do we control the mind? And he said, you can't control the mind, but you can only control it by mercy. So any taste we get, any depth of chanting, ultimately it's mercy. But if we offend a devotee or we live a very tamasic lifestyle, then we're not open to the mercy, which would give us the ability to go more deeply in the holy name. And that's why we follow four regular principles. If you don't follow the four regular principles, you're not going to stay in sattva guna. If you're not in sattva guna, your chanting, the potency of your chanting is going to diminish. Now you might say, but if I chant, won't I come to sattva guna so I can follow the principles? That understanding is there also. But it's much better. It works together. We have to maintain it. Chanting will help us maintain a sattvic life, and we have to maintain a sattvic life also. It's not just I chant and let whatever happens, happens. I also have to make the effort to live a sattvic life. So when we live a more rajasic or tamasic life, it has a negative impact on our chanting. And so sometimes devotees will say, well, when I chant, I'm bored, I don't feel anything, or I'm very distracted. And it may be that your life is a little too tamasic. You're engaged in activities which really undermine the consciousness we want to create to be able to chant properly. So this is something to look at, because it's kind of like pouring mud on yourself after you take a bath. You don't want to do that. And a lot of us do that, because everything we see and hear and touch and taste and smell is affecting this consciousness. So think of things that you can do that would help your chanting. More Krishna conscious activities, live a more sattvic lifestyle, more regulated, clean, don't eat late at night, don't overeat, don't complain, don't criticize, be tolerant, etc. These things are sattvic activities. These things actually support our chanting. So those are the three stages: before, while, and after. Hare Krishna.